My name's Scott Schurr. I'm just a software developer. I'm not a compiler designer. I'm not one of these amazing Boost folks. I just write software. And I think C++11 is pretty interesting, and I don't know everything about it, but I figured there were some corners of it that I could learn about. And these were containable enough corners to dig into. So this is the best I could figure out on brace initialization, unions, and enums. Ah, and the remote works too. Never trust technology. So here are the topics. I have executive summaries. If you know everything you need to know about brace initialization, you can go have some coffee for 20 minutes. We're going to be on this for at least 20 minutes. And really, what you want to know in the end is that when you're initializing, you usually want to prefer using brace initializers without an equal sign. That's a new capability in C++11. And when you're designing classes, you need to be aware of collisions between constructors that take standard initializer lists and those that don't. So if you know what that means, then you may already have all the information you need for this part of it, and you could go read a book for a little while. But let me continue. These are braces. This is initialization. So when you initialize an object, you give it its initial value. So it's very different from assignment, where the object already exists and you're throwing something new on top of it. So brace initialization is only about initialization. It is not about assignment. So here, because we can tell that we're initializing this thing because it's const. If it's const, you can't assign into it. Here we go. So assignment to const error. And if you, those of you, I'm assuming everyone in the room has had lots of experience with C++ 98 or 03. No disagreements. Okay. So one of the things that Jarn Strustrup and I think a number of other folks noted is that in terms of initialization, there are a lot of different ways to do it. There's copy initialization, which you can call direct initialization, which is using the parents. They said, yeah, we ought to be able to do that too. There's brace initialization, which happens in a bunch of places. And then there are other times when there's this function call syntax. So lots of different ways to do it. And you have to do it in the right way in the given circumstance. So you have to recognize, what am I trying to do? What is this thing that I'm trying to initialize? What is the correct syntax for me to use? So they didn't like that. Oh, and let's see, to continue on. There are some other places where you cannot initialize the object. For a vector, for example, you have to pass it a container in order to initialize the vector. Some things you cannot initialize. A quick aside about narrowing, because it will be relevant in just a couple of slides. Does everyone get what narrowing is? Okay, so the idea is if you got something that's too big, it's not going to fit in a smaller thing. There are situations in that the standard explicitly allows narrowing to happen. The compiler is allowed to give you a warning, because a compiler can give you a warning about anything it wants to give you a warning about. But it is not in violation of the standard for the compiler to perform this narrowing. And so you are entirely at the mercy of your compiler vendor and which warnings you and your team have chosen to turn on as to whether you get notified that narrowing is occurring in certain circumstances. So here is a case where the standard for C++ 98 explicitly allows narrowing, requires narrowing to be allowed. So I've got this array of ints, and I'm initializing it, I'm brace initializing it with doubles. The compiler says, this is okay. This is just fine. And so here, if we run this for a loop and do an assert, the asserts will not fire. So somebody thought that ought to get fixed. So in C++ 11, if you're doing brace initialization, then that now becomes a compiler error. This is new behavior. It is a breaking change. It will not be a silent breaking change because the compiler will see it. Your code will fail to compile. So if you're doing brace initialization, yes.
And aren't the equals optional there?
The equals in C++ 98 are not optional.
No, now you're in 11.
I'm not in 11 yet. Well, okay. Yes, right. So the place that we're going is that if you just have standard C++ 98 code that's been working fine for a long time, you throw the switch, say, hey, let's compile all this stuff in C++ 11. It'll work great, won't it? You can get this compiler error. Okay. Yes, where we're headed is to remove the equal sign. And so I should, do you want a glider or a finger trap? we'll hand out the first glider. I haven't put any of these gliders together yet. I don't know how well they work, but you should put that together now and see how it flies. So, and you guys in the back, it's dangerous for you because I get to throw at you. So in C++ 11, this narrowing is explicitly disallowed by the compiler or by the standard. So excellent lead in. The next slide is to remove the equal sign. This is new. C++ 11, they were thrashing about, how are we going to change initialization? How can we make this more uniform? What can we do that won't look too bogus? Well, OK, we do this initialization with parentheses without an equal sign, but the braces always require an equal sign. Why don't we just kind of pluck that equal sign out of there? And it's a brand new thing. It's not a very big textual change. But it makes a big difference in the behavior of the compiler on the initialization. So in this case, we've got C++ 11. I always grab for the wrong button. So we've in C++ 11, we have a new kind of syntax for doing initialization. And you can use this everywhere. Almost. We'll get to the details. Yes?
You said it makes a difference big difference with compiler if you have equal sign or not. Is that
yes,
true?
That is absolutely true.
Okay. I thought they were basically equivalent.
No. No. There are all sorts of rules about how the brace initialization. Ah, okay, thank you. I got my sign. Repeat the question. The question was, is there a difference between brace initialization with or without the equal sign? And my response is yes. And we'll get into and part of it is that you can use brace initialization without an equal sign in places where parentheses were previously required, and the only way to do it. So that's a big difference. So every place that we were using parentheses or braces with equal signs, all of those, you can now use just one form. You can use it for container initialization. You can initialize, and remember here we had, in the previous form, we had to have an extra container. We can do away with the extra container. We can just assign with the curly braces. With the member and new arrays, we can do that, the initialization of the data array here in place. And we can also do initialization of new arrays, which is something we could not do. You had to new the array, and it was constructed with a bunch of junk in it, and then you had to go set the values. You don't have to do that anymore. But it only works with this syntax. You can also use it in return values. So here I have a function called make2s, and I'm going to return an initialized or excuse me, make S2, I'm going to return initialized S2 implicitly, simply using the brace initialization. I'm going to use it on a function call. So here I have a function that takes in a vector of int, and all I'm going to do is I'm going to use the brace initialization. The compiler will take care of the rest of it for me. Yes?
But can you
Yeah.
What happens if you pass too many numbers to...
I have a slide for that.
Oh, okay.
Do you want a glider or a finger trap? Well, I'm going to throw this as far as it goes, and then it needs to be passed back. Nice.
It works.
Oh, that's nice. Okay. So, anytime you try to slide something like this in, it looks like it works seamlessly on a pre-existing standard as complicated as C++. You know, somebody put a lot of thought into it. They had to work pretty hard at it. So there are different corners in brace initialization. And depending on what kind of type you are initializing, you have slightly different behavior. So we're going to dive into, this truly is sweating the small stuff. We're going to dive into what is the behavior of brace initialization, depending on what type you're initializing. And one of the important distinctions is whether you're initializing an aggregate or not. So there are plain ordinary types, you know, things that are built in. There are aggregates, and then there are things that are not aggregates in terms of brace initialization. So an aggregate is an array or a class with no user-provided constructors, no initializers for non-static data members, no private or protected non-static data members. So this is all about non-static stuff. No base classes and no virtual functions. So this is not plain old data. This is an aggregate. This is an aggregate too. More aggregates. So you have an array. You have a struct. The struct is an aggregate because it doesn't have all those other things. A class, as long as everything is public, this too is an aggregate. An array, standard array, is also an aggregate because the standard has a special, it's not an exception, it's a command on the implementation of the standard array that it must conform to being an aggregate. So this struct, even though it's a struct, it's not an aggregate. Can you tell me why? Okay, who said that first? They get a finger trap. It would. Somebody back there? Okay. Send it back. This too is not an aggregate. The reason is? Shout it!
Base class.
All right, I heard it loudest over here.
No, I already got an airplane.
Oh, I already got an airplane. You want a finger trap? Oh, you already have one. I could give you a glider. All right. You only get two, though. So, now that we know what aggregates are, we're going to talk about what happens when you brace initialize an aggregate. So, the elements in the aggregate, remember, nothing is private. So, the compiler is free to just throw things at any of these members. They're all just wide open to the world. So, it's going to throw those values in order from the beginning to the end, in the order in which they're declared. In the case of an array, you know, that's array index 0 out. In the case of a struct, it's the order of the declaration. So, you know, there's the array. There's the struct with two entries. 8 goes in first. 9 goes in second. A standard array holds a single element. That element holds an array. Someone who's really good with a standard is welcome to disagree with me. This was my experience in GCC 4.7.0. The standard itself says that an array is an aggregate that can be initialized with the syntax array, da-da-da-da-da-da, when an initializer list is a comma-separated list of up to n elements whose types are convertible to T. They don't say whether it's required that there be just a single set of braces. So I'm not 100% sure that you need the extra braces. This is what GCC 4.7 required. So if you've got a union, unions also brace initialize. And what they'll do is they'll brace initialize the very first member of the union. So in this case, we've got a char star, that's our first element. So I've got a hi mom, that goes in just fine. If I want to initialize the union with a zero, that's also fine because a zero is a legitimate pointer. But if I try to drop a one in there, the compiler will say, no, no go. So don't get fooled if you drop that zero and you think you're initializing the I. No, that's going into the pointer. Yes? Thank you. I think the question was, can you initialize it with a hex value? Is that correct? Yes. I'll repeat this again. I will be happier, and you may be happier, if you move toward the front, because then I can hear questions and so forth. So, yes.
So if you empty initialize this thing with empty brackets, you're going to get a null pointer, a null putter, or a zero? I mean, they end up being a zero, but...
Yeah, so there is a slide for that. And we'll go ahead and get ahead of ourselves. You get a finger trap.
You just lost me.
if you give empty braces, that's equivalent to what you get with empty parents today, which will zero initialize an integer or a float or a double and give a zero or a null pointer to a pointer type. So that's, and we're getting ahead of ourselves, yeah. So one of the questions earlier was, what happens if you give too many arguments and the compiler will yell at you? If you have too few arguments, the compiler tries to make something up. So if you have too few arguments on a fundamental type, they get what is now default initialized. So they'll get zeros or null pointers. If you have a user-defined type that doesn't have a constructor, basically if you have a user-defined type that's an aggregate, then the members will get zeroed. If you have a user-defined type with a default constructor, then the default constructor is called. And finally, if you have a user-defined type with no default constructor, then you have an error. Or a deleted default constructor. And here are some examples. So here's a struct. We have an aggregate that contains a struct, which is also an aggregate. And the things in there are going to get zeroed. A user-defined type with a default constructor. So here's our user-defined type. Here's our default constructor. And we're going to initialize x, our member, with 7. So we'll call the empty braces. And that default constructor gets called. A user-defined type with no default constructor, so we've got a constructor that's not default, that requires an argument. In that case, we will not compile. It's all done with aggregates. Now we move on to the more interesting types. A non-aggregate, the brace initialization, will do its best fit on the constructor call. So here I've got brace initialization. I've got three different constructors, brace initialization for the three different kinds of constructors, and it always calls the right kind of constructor. So at this level, if you have a user-defined type, you don't have to do anything special to support brace initialization. The compiler does it for you. Again, empty braces invoke the default constructor. If there is no default constructor, the compiler will yell at you, saying you cannot brace initialize this. So this is an interesting point for talking about narrowing again. Because here I've got a struct with an explicit constructor. And the compiler says, if I want to pass a two-point zero, a float, into this constructor that requires an integer. The standard allows this. The standard allows this even in C++ 11, because if they change the rule on this, too much code would break. But brace initialization without equal signs is new. It's brand new, so they can change the rules. So here, because we're doing brace initialization rather than parenthetical initialization, we're going to get a compile time error. So the rule, unfortunately, for, you know, because the rule should be at the top in big letters, right? Just a second. So you usually prefer brace initialization. Yes?
Is that because of the explicit?
No.
No.
No, it's because of the braces. Ah, the quest, thank you. The question was, is it because of the explicit? And the answer is, no, it's not because of the explicit. It's because of the braces. The braces are the things that do not allow it to narrow. And it's actually the same rule whether you have an equal sign or not. In this case, because it's a non-aggregate, you couldn't have used the form that of brace initialization with the equal sign. That was not valid in C++ 98. So, but it is the braces that prevent the narrowing. Now we get to the most interesting type, which is brace initialization, basically of containers. So if you have a non-aggregate container, you initialize the contents with a standard initializer list. And I bet that should have been an underscore. My apologies.
Just maybe.
So it's right here. So here we've got examples of container types in the standard library that now take brace initialization. When you see this in an interface, what that really says is, yeah, okay, it looks like we're asking for some kind of a funny type. What it really means is you can pass in a brace, a list of things surrounded by curly braces. So here's what you would do with a simple container, and notice that you don't have to have, you know, a literal value present in the braces. You can be picking these values up from wherever and dropping them in. So here we've got a variable I, we've got a function that returns something. We can just drop those right inside the braces. The compiler just takes care of it for you. You have a more interesting container like a map. When I first heard about the brace initialization, well, how are they going to deal with maps? Okay, well, you deal with maps because internally maps are regular. Yes?
Shouldn't the two be double braces in the vehicle, similar to how the map is?
So
basically, one is the call to the construct and the other one is actual.
The question is, should there be double braces in which part?
Vector.
Up here, the vector. The vector doesn't require double braces. I don't know. Did I? Okay. I'm forgetting whether I'm actually repeating the question. And I don't believe that the double braces are necessary. And the compiler takes this just fine. So I compiled all of these examples at least once. So hopefully they're okay. There's still copy and paste problems. Okay. Let's see. Do you want a glider or a finger trap?
Glider.
I figured the gliders would probably be popular. Could you pass that back? If I pre-assembled them, then I could throw them at people, but they're more likely to take turns. You had a question.
What happens if you pass only one argument to the vector constructor?
Yeah, so the vector, and this has to do with the way the vector constructor is defined on the initializer list. The initializer list has three member functions, one of which is the size of the initializer list. So the vector constructor that takes an initializer list is defined so that the vector sizes itself to the initializer list. So as many arguments as are in the initializer list, in
yes,
this case.
Usually vector used to have before a constructor with one argument, that's meant just size of this vector, yes?
We'll get there. And you definitely get a glider for this. But that was a setup question. Yeah. Well, okay. So the question was, thank you. The question was, what happens when you pass a single argument in the brace initialized list to a vector? My answer is, we'll see that the answer to that in a couple of slides. So standard initializer, or the initializer list header file, is magic. It allows the compiler to convert that into a standard initializer list. What you need to notice is that when we were, well, I'm getting ahead of myself again. Let's see if I can catch up. Now, let's go through some of the details before I get ahead of myself. So the standard initializer list stores its values in an array. The underlying array is not guaranteed to exist beyond the duration of the initializer list. So if the initializer list goes out of scope, its data also effectively goes out of scope. The initializer list has three methods. It has a size, a begin, and an end. And so let's construct something that has, we're going to, this is way simpler than a vector, but we're going to give it two constructors. It has a constructor that doesn't take an initializer list. It takes a single int value. And it has a constructor that takes an initializer list of int values. And we've got two different behaviors here. And we'll give it an array index operator just for fun. So we're overloading. We've got one that one constructor that takes just a single value and one that takes an initializer list. Whenever you construct a brace initializer list like this, it always prefers, if there's an initializer list overload available on the constructor or anything else, and we'll get to that a little bit later, that initializer lists can be used places other than constructors. But anytime it sees an initializer list, it's going to say, that's where I need to go. So there's a built-in bias inside of the standard saying, if I see braces and there's an initializer list, I'm going there. So you'll notice that with our two overloads, I can't, if I'm using brace initialization without the equal sign all the time, I can't get to this one. So there are very rare cases where you cannot use this. They don't happen very often. But you need to be aware of that, that you know you, there are, because this was something that was troweled in on a pre-existing language, there are places that they can't paper it all over. What I just described also shows up in the standard library. Now, I don't know that anybody ever makes a list of ints or a vector of ints or anything as simple as that. But if you were to do that, and then you were previously asking about if you brace initialize a vector with a single integer, and it's a vector of integers, then in that case, when you brace initialize that vector with a single integer, what you get is a vector containing that single integer, not a vector that is pre-initialized to the size of that. And that was a, think that, yeah, because the initializer list, well, I wouldn't even guess, because I'm not on the standard committee. I'm sure they had reasons why they chose to do that. And that may have been for uniformity, I don't know. So if we're doing conversion, yeah, we're doing all right time-wise. I think, actually, just as an aside, I think one of the reasons that I was scheduled into this room is because there's a clock that I can look at. The last two talks I did last year went way over time, so I'm going to try to keep an eye on that. Did I see a hand in the back? No? Okay. So we've got conversion rules. I've got to get reoriented. Right. So we've got an overload on two constructors. We've got an initializer list of ints, an initializer list of doubles. What am I going to pick? If I've got floats, floats unambiguously don't narrow, converting to doubles. So this one's going to call the constructor that takes the doubles. This one, we're going to get a compile error. And compile time errors are your favorite kinds of errors, whether you know that or not. So you'll get a compile time error because it doesn't know. If we make long doubles and make an array of those, then it won't do that because that's narrowing. We're inside of braces. The data in an initializer list may not outlive the initializer list. Now that's a may not because the compiler doesn't say how long it might live. The standard says how long it has to live, and that's what you have to work with. So your initializer list data may actually sit there forever, but you can't rely on that. So when you pick up stuff from an initializer list, don't pick up its address. Pick up the value. Initializer list can be templatized. So we've got an initializer list of T. And here, we're going to call the constructor with a float, because these are all uniform. If it's not uniform, then the compiler will bark. You can also use standard initializer lists for other kinds of functions. So here's an operator's equal. These are all out of the standard library. Here's an operator's equal. There's an assign. There's an insert, where you say, at this position, insert this stuff. So when you see this interface, when you're, for all of us who read the standard, I'm sure we all do. We spend every night reading the standard for a half an hour before we go to sleep, right?
Well, I try, but usually after about 5 minutes, I'm asleep.
You're done, yeah. Yeah. It works well.
Takes you that long.
Yeah. Finger trap for Marshall. Okay, but we're talking about brace initialization. We could go a lot of other places with initializer lists, but I'm not going to drag you through that. Yes?
I was actually going to comment, like, one limitation I think with initializer lists that I hit recently was size is not a const expert. So it's hard to, I mean, even though to me it feels like it should be, the compiler should know the size of the elements at compile time, so you could use that to, you know, emit a nice compile time error based on size. You can't do that.
Right. So, thank you. Yeah, this was a comment, not a question, but you still get a glider. One of the limitations with initializer lists, could you pass that back? Thanks. Is that the size member function of an initializer list is not const expert. So you can't operate on that at compile time. Even though the compiler actually knows that value, it isn't const expert. I would suspect that's something that someone in the standard committee is saying, gee, maybe we should change that. So we may see that change. I don't know. Seems like that would be a non-breaking change. I said seems. I don't know. Yes, Marshall.
There was a long discussion about const expert in general, and whether or not, you know, whether or not library implementations had the freedom to designate additional stuff as const expert in a recent committee meeting.
Yeah.
And it turns out that SpinA is good enough that you can check that, and you can have React programs that behave differently depending on whether or not, say, initializer list size is in fact const expert.
Yeah.
And so it's a big rabbit hole.
Yeah.
Because SpinA has gotten so good.
Yeah.
The whole idea of the as-if rule is just out the window in many cases.
So what Marshall was just saying, forego the sign, what Marshall was just saying is that library vendors are probably not at leisure to declare a function as const expert if the standard doesn't declare the function as const expert. That if you declare the function as const expr and it's not in the standard, that that can lead to other problems because the code has gotten really good at digging around and saying, what is the real interface on this function? But okay, so I've gotten to the end of brace initialization. You guys can go. I'll go. You know, we're done with that. So the summary at the end is the same as the summary at the beginning. You usually prefer using brace initializers without, or brace initialization without an equal sign. That almost always does what you want. And when you're designing your classes, try to avoid the trap that has been left with vector and list. Where there are some things that you would like to be able to initialize with brace initializers, and you can't do it. Yes?
What are the guarantees on the order of evaluation of the elements inside the initializer list? Because with overloading operator comma, you might have big troubles.
Yeah.
So what are the guarantees here?
Yeah. So the question is, thank you, the question is, what is the guarantee of the order of evaluation within the brace initializer list? And I have not researched this, and I hope that someone who's really good with C++ is in the room. My guess is that there is no guarantee, because my understanding is that for most function calls, there's no guarantee of the order of evaluation. So I'm not seeing anyone disagree with me. So I think there is no guarantee. And I'm way open for someone to say, yeah, that's not, or you're not right, and they would know better. Yes?
Well, I think you're correct, and I think you mentioned the comma operator, which isn't applicable in this case.
Okay. Yeah. Oh, thanks. Yeah, don't want to lose the mic. Okay. On to unions.
Scott?
Yes?
If you're finished with brace initialization, I don't want to jump ahead if this was something you were going to talk about, but one of my favorite gotchas in 11 is the interesting combination between brace initialization and auto, because you probably aren't going to get what you expect.
Yeah, so that was one that I specifically omitted because I wanted to stay with brace initialization. Ah, okay, there's the repeat the question sign. So John's saying that one of his favorite gotchas is relates to how brace initialization and auto work together or don't.
Work together in unexpected ways.
Work together in unexpected ways. I did not dig into that. I don't have any slides on it.
Well, the main thing is that if you say auto I and then in braces 7.
Yes.
I think most people would expect that they're going to get I being an integer with a value of 7.
Yeah, and what they get is an initializer list.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. So, so maybe it's worth saying out loud. So John was just explaining what I'm hoping I will explain again in less good terms, is that if you have auto something or other, curly braces, stuff inside the curly braces, close the curly braces, what you will always get out of that, even though it might have made sense otherwise, what you will always get out of that is an initializer list. So curly braces, when auto sees a curly brace, it says, I know you. You're an initializer list. So thank you, John. So yeah. So I, yes.
To an earlier question in 854, paragraph 4, every value computation and side effect associated with a given initializer clause.
Hold on. I don't want to have to repeat this.
So in 854, paragraph 4, every value computation and side effect associated with a given initializer clause is sequenced before every value computation and side effect associated with any initializer clause that follows it in the comma-separated list of the initializer list.
Here, can you put that in English?
Well, so they're evaluated left to right, and they're sequenced before, so any synchronization kinds of issues, it's each one is evaluated independently and in order.
Okay. So Rob gets a glider. Huh? Yeah, see, it was actually a good thing. It didn't have a clip.
I guess.
Yeah. Yeah. So Rob gets a glider. John gets a glider. I've got more gliders. So. All you folks are being shy. Look at what you're missing out on.
Scott, I think you've got some chalk up there. Why don't you write the auto surprise that you were just saying out loud?
Maybe auto I can. Expert. Yeah, let me recruit John. See, when you speak up, you have to go on stage. Another question, yes.
I think you answered it before, but for final clarification, for all cases where the equal is optional on race initialization, it has no effect semantically, right? In other words, if you can put it equal, it makes no difference. Is that true or not true?
I didn't look hard enough.
You said don't use the equal.
Yeah, don't
and
use.
And in that other case, but it was context sensitive,
yeah.
You said the compiler treats the equal very differently.
Yeah,
but I don't think that you. I get some ambiguity there.
I think so the question is, if it worked with the equal sign before, are you out anything if you leave the equal sign in place?
Well, that's one part.
Okay, so yes. I got one of the questions so far, yeah. and I did not research that closely. My intuition is that you're correct that if it has the equal sign now. That you don't gain anything more by removing the equal sign.
And I can infer from what you're saying then that there is no case where the equal sign is allowed where it wasn't already allowed before.
That is correct.
Okay.
So the question was, is there a place now where the equal sign would be allowed that it wasn't previously allowed? And the answer is no. Any place you could use the equal sign before, you can still use it. There are no additional places where the equal sign can be used. Thank you.
It has no effect.
It has no effect.
Okay.
Yeah. To my best understanding.
Back to John's example. The question I would have is whether that differs in behavior, whether or not you've included initializer list.
So Rob asked, does John's example, which it's hard to read on that. It's an official blackboard. You don't see blackboards very much. So the question is, if you have not seen the include of initializer list, what does John's example do? My best guess would be is that it would fail to compile, because it wouldn't know what to do with the curly braces. But I don't know that. Yes.
Initializer list is implicitly included, I think, in every translation unit.
Okay, so the statement was initializer list is implicitly included in every translation unit. That doesn't match my understanding, but you're probably better at this than I am. So I'm inclined to believe that, yeah, that's not the way I understood it.
We're trying how to build initializer lists, but whether or not you see the actual type initializer list depends on whether you see the header or not.
Yeah, so that. And I don't. The impression that I got from what the stuff that I read, and I'm not very good at standardese. I do spend some time with the standard, but it is dense stuff. The impression that I got is that if you want to use initializer list, you really need to explicitly include it. But I could easily be wrong on that.
GCC complains if you don't include it.
Okay, so here we have a case where GCC wants to see that header file. Are we ready to move on to unions? Okay. So, unions, I think, are particularly, maybe appropriately, ignored most of the time by most folks. So, let's talk about what a union is so that we've got the right context. A union looks like a struct, but everything that it contains is at the same location. So here we have a struct, and we can say that, you know, where is X, where is Y? They're at different addresses. Here we have a union. We have an X and we have a Y. we can do a static assert and say, hey, these two guys are at the same address. A union, whereas with a struct is big enough to hold everything that it contains. A union is big enough to hold whatever is biggest inside of it, but only one of those. So this is where unions start to come into play, is that they are a way of saving space. If you're interested in trying to keep your program small, or at least your data storage small, oh, I see the finger trap is being useful. That's good. So if you're trying to save space, then people start thinking about unions. What?
I said, I sneezed.
Oh, Gesundheit.
By the way, I confirmed what Joel, I think it was, said. If you compile that with Clang, it complains whether or not initializer list is included, and it gives you an error message that says, basically, can't deal with this initializer list.
Yeah, okay.
So the compiler knows about initializer list, even if you don't include the header file.
Yeah, but so it knows about the initializer list, but it requires the header file to actually do the work. So Marshall, have you gotten a glider yet?
I think you gave him a finger trap because you ran out of muzzles.
Oh, now here, okay. So I've got a glider for Marshall. Thank you, Marshall. Let's see. Now I'm going backwards. Let's not go backwards. Okay. And so one of the points with this is that it's big enough to hold its largest element. So a union can hold one of its elements at a time. You can't, if you're thinking you've defined three things in this union and you start dropping things in there, whatever you put in last is what's really there. So I guess I've got a slight confession to make. I picked up C++ a long time ago, mostly by messing around with the compiler. And when I messed around with unions, at that time, the compiler didn't do, you try to put a member function on a union. It said, no, you can't do that. But if you look in the C++ 98 standard, you can. So I learned a whole bunch of stuff about unions while I was doing this, a lot of which applies to C++ 98. So if you guys are union experts already in C++ 98, I'm going to bore you and tell you about some of the stuff you could do with unions in C++ 98 that I didn't know about, and maybe you don't either. So in C++ 98 even, don't jump ahead, union members can have access control. You can have a private member of a union. I'm not sure what, there may be good reasons to do that. And I think what they were doing is saying, well, is there a reason not to do this? So, make it look more like a struct or a class. By default, the members are public. You can put a struct inside of a union. The union contains one struct at a time. So if we make two structs and we put those two structs, so here we have our union, U2, and it contains one of these two at a given time. Let's drop one of these in. And actually, it's worth noting, here, when we construct our U2, the U2 doesn't have any, it has space, but it doesn't have anything in it. Even though it has, you can access both of these members, neither one of them is initialized yet. So we can assign into here. We can assign our S2C into here. We can assign our S2D into here. And then we can look at what's in here. Usually someone from BoostCon would have jumped on the previous example and said, look, you were examining the value that you hadn't previously initialized. So in general, when you put something into the union, unions are time sensitive. So whatever form it got touched in last, generally you should be referring to that thing, not the other thing, or any of the other things. Yes, Marshall?
I believe when you say should, you mean if you want to avoid undefined behavior.
Marshall's point is, when I said should, Marshall said if you want to avoid undefined behavior. And yeah, I think that's an excellent way to put it. But I will say that the standard actually has a cop-out on this one. If the structs that you've been messing with have a common initial sequence, and these two structs do, so we're putting the same kinds of things in the front, then the standard actually provides me an out. And I can look at that first element, or as many elements as are common between the structs. It says, yeah, we'll let you do that. So, and there's the paragraph. So not that you'll be doing that every day, but I think it's worth knowing about. And chances are, when you're writing code with unions, you're not digging through the standard to see whether I can do that. You're messing with the union and saying, I wonder if this will work. And it works on your compiler. But knowing that says, well, it probably ought to work on most of your compilers. And any compiler where it doesn't work is broken. So let's see. We're going to initialize a union. Let's go ahead and we've got a type identifier for what's in our union, and then we've got structs that carry those. When you're initializing the union, if you just drop a union down someplace and it doesn't have a constructor, which we'll get to in a minute, then you get indeterminate values in here. If you external brace initialize a union, then what goes in is the first union member. We talked about that with brace initialization first. Yes?
Question, does the error comes from not allowing an error in or from not allowing actually to initialize the second member of the union?
So the question was, is it because of not allowing narrowing or not because of initializing the second part of the union? So it really is the first. In this case, it's because you're not allowing narrowing. Because when the compiler sees this assignment, it says, I can only be assigning to the first member. It knows where it's going. So when it sees this value, it says, I can't narrow that into the first element. OK, so internal brace initialization is something that's new with C++11, and I'm not going into the details of that. But be aware that you can declare a struct like this and initialize values in place. And with a union, you can only do one of these things. If you try to initialize more than one member, then the compiler will yell at you, which that's a good thing. I want the compiler to yell at me for stuff like that. So if you provide constructors for your union, and so we're now learning you can give a union a constructor, now we've got ways of constructing either one of these things.
Can I go back?
Yeah.
Yeah, just waiting for it to show. Can you go back?
Ah, okay.
Is there any way you can make those constructors constexts?
Can you make union constructors const expert? My guess would be yes, but I didn't try it. So that's just a guess. I know of no reason not to. And you probably ought to get a glider. I've got more gliders. So. Oh, no, we got to do this. And if you would prefer a finger trap, you can always say, no, give me a finger trap. OK. So constructors. Unions could have member functions, as we just saw. You can provide constructors. No virtual functions. Why is that? It's because if you have a virtual function, every implementation that I've ever heard of, the way virtual functions are implemented is with a virtual pointer. And you can't have a virtual pointer and something else in the union at the same time, because the union only contains one thing. A union may not have a base class, and it cannot be a base class. Okay, so here's where we're getting to some of the differences between C++ 98 and C++ 11. So in C++ 98, you cannot put in a union an object with a non-trivial constructor or with non-trivial copy assignment or non-trivial destructor. And non-trivial just means you provided one. Or an object with any virtual member, or an array of any of these, or a static data member, or a reference type, or a virtual member function. In effect, a union is a table saw with a guard. Okay, this is making sense. I kind of like the analogy, but nobody's laughing, so I was disappointed. C++ 11, a bunch of these constraints have been removed. These types are allowed in a union. You still can't put in a reference type, and you can't provide a virtual member function. All the rest of this stuff can now go into a union in C++ 11. When I read that, this was the feeling that I had about unions in C++ 11. So, and this is from the standard, in general, one must use explicit destructor calls and placement new operators to change the active member of a union. Now, that is entirely in general, that there are, if you know what you're putting, I will get you in just a second, yeah. If you know what you're putting in there, you don't have to follow that rule. So it's a function of what you put in your union. So one of the first, in the summary rules at the front, it was like, what's the primary rule about a union? Know what you're putting in your union. This is maybe not a smart thing to put in a template where you can throw arbitrary T's into a union. If you do that, you've got to handle it very, very carefully. So there was a question and a figure trap to go with it.
How does the union handle a static data member if you say I have like a static int and then a char below it?
Uh-huh.
How would it keep track of that static int if you're changing over to a char?
Yeah, so the question is, how does a union handle a static member? And the answer is, because the static doesn't occupy space inside of the union. You can have as many statics inside of a union and the single union member simultaneously. So, yeah, thank you. Thank you. I think we're actually on time. I'm hoping we're on time. So, my feeling about unions is that people are often kind of blithe with reinterpret casts or whatever they need to do. I still see C-style casts in the code at my office, even though they make me flinch. So I think unions are preferable to things like reinterpret cast, because you know what your choices of types are. Reinterpret casts will just go from any arbitrary thing to any arbitrary thing. So you're limiting the scope when you declare the union. And you've got controlled access. That's me. The other thing, the reason that the missing thumb picture is not quite that dangerous. So when the rules were opened up on unions, there were additional factors that were included that the compiler now makes it a little bit safer to be dropping stuff in there. So every union starts with the following implicit member functions, and they're kind of your six standard things, same as everybody else, yeah. and you know, including the move guys, which are new with C++ 11. And if you put into a union a type that has an explicit non-trivial one of these functions, then the union has that implicit method deleted. So this is the implicit method. In this case, we've dropped something into the union that has a non-trivial default constructor and a non-trivial destructor. So whatever that happens to be, in that case, the union loses these two members. You cannot call those two things on the union. But once those have been removed, you are welcome to provide one for yourself or for your union consumers. So dropping the thing in will make a gap, a hole, which you may choose to leave in place. Or you can fill it in. So it's not quite so bad. There's still a guard on the table saw. But it's a different guard than used to be there. It wasn't a, you can't put that kind of wood in here. It's a, we're going to change the blade when you put that kind of material in here. So let's, we'll create a struct that has two constructors, and we'll drop that into a union. Just the presence of this struct in this union means that you can't, we have deleted the default constructor. So you can't do this. The compiler will say, nope, won't go there. Now you can still do aggregate initialization, and that will aggregate initialize the first member of the union. That's only true for this particular example. Yes?
You can't do that in somewhere where it actually will automatically call the destructor, because the destructor doesn't exist.
This doesn't have an explicit destructor. So, the point, thank you. The point was, this won't work. If place had a destructor, then the destructor for the union would have been removed. Place doesn't have an explicit destructor. Therefore, this works. The only thing that place has, the only of those interesting methods, the only one that it has is the constructor. So did I do good? Good. Okay, so now we're gonna fix it. We're not gonna mess with the thing we wanna put in the union. We're gonna mess with the union. So our constructor was removed. Let's put the constructor in, and we're gonna say, oh, okay, I know what I have in here. That's the rule with unions, know what you're putting in there. I know what I have in here. When I default construct, I want to default construct and initialize stuff, the P element. And I'm going to call, I chose to call the two argument constructor. So I can now call the user supply constructor, just a minute. And you'll notice that what had worked previously, so on the previous slide, we were able to do this initialization. We can't do that now. Because we supplied a constructor to the union no longer accepts aggregate initialization. It's not an aggregate. So there was a question over here.
Did you choose to, in the default constructor, you're calling P?
Yes.
Do you have to, or can you just provide an empty default constructor?
You can provide an empty default constructor. Once you're writing the constructor, it's all up to you. Do anything you want. You can go erase your hard drive or, you know. And yeah, let's say you get a finger trap.
Thank you.
Yes?
What if in this default constructor of a union you instead initialized I? My assumption is that then no constructor will be called for P.
So the question was if in your constructor here, here we're if instead of initializing P, we initialized I, which we absolutely could, then there would be no initialization for P. I think that's not the case, because you can, even though you can't initialize P, what you can do is assign to it once the union is constructed.
Well, placement if we new. Initialized I and
it would have to be placement new?
Because it's got no state to assign to. You haven't established the invariance by default constructor then. Only I has been initialized.
Yeah.
There's space for a place, but no place object.
Yeah, see, I believe that, and I don't know whether this is valid, but I believe that, and that once I've constructed the union, I can, if I know what I'm assigning into well enough, you know, that place is not so complicated that, and you'll notice that X and Y are public, for example. I can do assignment into P. I believe that to be the case.
Undefined behavior.
Okay, I'll give that. It may have undefined behavior. Yes, Marshall.
Yeah, I wanted to agree with Rob that it's undefined behavior. Yes, it will probably work, but there's no place object there because the constructor hasn't run. There's just memory.
Yeah. Okay. And you know, it's good for me to be doing this at BoostCon. We'll see some other examples where I am just doing assignment into things that were not properly initialized. And that is old C++ 98 behavior. I believe it still works. And the standard may be saying, that's not guaranteed. I think it will still work.
I think to follow up,
I think that relates to the earlier comment in the standard about using placement new and the destructs and false.
Yeah. So the comment was that relates to the comment in the standard, which was a non-normative note, I believe, that you should use placement new and explicit destructor calls. And depending on the type, this gets down to knowing what is your type. How complicated is this type? So here we've got something that is just barely not an aggregate. And again, not necessarily following the rules of the standard, but my belief is that in almost all cases, even though you haven't run a constructor on P, that you can still assign into it and have it behave. And Rob's going to disagree with me.
All I was going to say is all that has to happen is some maintainer comes along, changes the definition of place in some way that violates that, and all the code where you made that assumption will be broken.
Okay. And Rob said appropriately is that if some maintainer comes along and messes with place, then every assumption you made about that is wrong. And I'll agree with that entirely. So moving on, oh, and I am running behind schedule. So this was something that was also available in C++ 98, but I didn't know about it. And once I found out about it, I said, hey, that's cool. So there are anonymous unions. You don't have to name a union. So you can declare a union without a name, and now I can access D without accessing I. Or, you know, as long as I have to keep track of this in my brain, I and D are at the same address. But I can get into D. Anonymous unions are not as wide open as regular unions. You can't put in private or protected members, no statics, no member functions. If they are at global or namespace scope, they have to be static. A union for which objects or pointers are declared is not anonymous. So here we have a union without a name, but it's got an object. So that is not anonymous. So. Yeah, I'm running behind schedule, so I'll have to flip through these fairly quickly so we can get to enums. I said, maybe I ought to try out some of this stuff. So I decided to make a class that can contain a string, a U16 string, or a U32 string, or potentially nothing, and see what was involved with putting that in the union. So in general, with your union, you have to keep track of what you've got in there. Is there? No, there isn't a hand up. Okay. So you need some way of tracking what you got. You need a discriminator. So I've got that. I've got an enum that keeps track of what I'm containing. I have a place to keep that. I'm using an anonymous union to keep track of what I'm storing right now. So this is really a class. This is not a union, but it is a union-like class. And in order to get this to work fairly easily, I made a bunch of private helper functions that I'm calling assign so that I can get the value that somebody handed to me. I can drop that into the union and make sure that I maintain my discriminator in every single one of those cases. So I always want to call my helper function so that my discriminator and my actual contents never get out of sync. Yes?
Shouldn't you first destroy the previously assigned value?
And we'll get to this. This is a helper function, and there's a reason to not be doing the destruction in this particular case. So this is not called by users. This is a private member function. And we're going to make yet more of these. So here, these are the various kinds of strings that can get dropped in there. Here we've got somebody passing in any string. We have to declare, because both of these interfaces got explicitly deleted because of the string types going in, you have to, well, and these are helper functions, so that's irrelevant. What I just said is completely irrelevant. Yes?
If you go back to the previous slide, your move, the move versions of the functions don't actually use move. They don't actually move.
They don't actually move? That could be. I'm not a C++ pro. So what he's saying, so the statement was that the move versions of these functions don't actually move. If that's the case, I apologize. I'll own up to that mistake. You have a glider yet?
No.
Okay, you need a glider. So more helper functions so that I can take a reference to a const reference to one of these things or an R value reference. So if someone hands me a string literal, I'm going to create a string and then hand that to my broken move operator. And I also have to know how to destroy these things. And the destroy always looks at what kind am I, and then destroys the correct thing in place. Now we're going to get to the actual work. So those are all helper functions. So for the constructors, we don't need to destroy the contents. So that's the reason that the assign just drops things in. So for constructors, we just call assign. And we've got a perfect forwarding constructor, which may or may not work. I'm not going to make any guarantees on that. So our assignment from a const reference was deleted because strings have that. So we have to provide that. And in this case, because we're doing assignment, we have to destroy whatever is down there. And we've got our discriminator to keep track of that. And then we do the assignment.
And of course, that's not exception safe.
Right. And so Rob's point is that's not exception safe. So, but there's only so far I wanted to go with this. Okay, so, but yeah, Rob's point is completely valid. What I'm doing is not exception safe. Okay, so then here's assignment and, you know, someone may, one of the things I worried about when I put these slides together is what is the proper C++11 way to compare two pointers which may or may not be of different types?
Don't bother.
What's that?
Don't bother to rewrite this.
Okay, so Rob's telling me this was a bad example, and that's fine. And then you need the destructor. One of the things I found out about unions is it's about unions and their alignment, that the compiler keeps track of what it contains, what the union contains, and it will align to whatever is contained in the union that has the greatest alignment constraints. So this particular page is an example of a bad thing to do with placement new. So here I've just declared an unsigned char array for Duver, and here's my placement new. And you know, we could have dropped Duver at any sort of an arbitrary place in alignment, and that would be a bad thing to do. So the other examples of bad things to do, this one's intentional. This really is
not unique to unions.
No,
the same
problem
is true for structs and classes.
So what this is an example of bad placement new. And a way to address that, and I'm not going to say it's the only way because there's a bunch of alignment stuff, and I think there's a talk on that later on. A way to address that is to drop whatever it is you want to do placement new on into a union. And now the union makes sure that the alignment happens. D won't get constructed. And now you just do your placement new into your anonymous union, and everything works. So I think unions are kind of a cool way to address alignment issues in placement new. Here's the summary. We're going to whip through enums because we've only got 10 minutes left. I couldn't find a cute picture for enums. I looked all over the place. Does anybody have a good enum joke? No? I couldn't find one of those either. Okay, so the changes are enums can declare their storage type, which is way cool. Something I think is even cooler, but leverages this, is that you can now forward declare enums. Years ago, I said to the standard committee, you've got to be able to forward declare these things because I have any number of header files. The only reason I had to include the header file was because there was a freaking enum in there. So now you can forward declare these guys. It's a good thing. And there is a new type of enum called enum class. Enums are C++'s, in my opinion, simplest way to produce a new type. So think about those. You know, if you're passing ints or whatever around, consider dropping those into enums instead. So same old, your usual old enum. What can you do with those new with C++ 11? You can declare the storage type. That's brand new. So you put a colon in there. You say what kind of an underlying type do I want for my enum? The underlying type can be any signed or unsigned integer type. This is also good for interfaces because before this, the compiler decided for you how big is this enum. And depending on what it saw, it could change from one compiler rev to the next, whether it wanted to put that into a char or an unsigned char or an int or whatever else. So you've now got control, well, a lot more control over your enum. And if you drop in a value, it has to fit in the underlying type. So if the compiler is going to help you out. If I put an unsigned char in here and the unsigned char of my compiler is something that can't accept 128, then it will say, no, you can't do that. So once you've given it an underlying type, you can now forward declare it. And if I lost my...
It's by your foot.
Oh, it's down by my foot. So most of the audio is going to be me dragging the microphone there. I guess the clips are useful after all. So if the compiler sees both the forward declaration and the actual definition, and they disagree, then the compiler will yell at you and say, hey, you screwed up. I'm not going to finish compiling. So with old enums, the enumerators always leak into the surrounding scope. So you know, here I've got an enum that I'm declaring, and I can, without saying that this is inside of my WE5, I can just directly refer to onion and shallot. But with C++11, and those will stay there. Those continue to leak. But they're also available inside. And you might ask, why in the heck would you want to do that? We'll see that in a minute when we get to Enum class. So problems with old enums, their enumerators would leak. And no one likes a leaky enumeration. And they also convert to integral type with almost no provocation. So there are a new type of enums called scoped enums. They don't leak their enumerators, and they don't spontaneously convert to int. And you make one of these by saying enum class. And you can do the same kind of colon whatever to say what the underlying type is. And you'll notice that these guys don't leak their names. So here we've got a static assert, salt equals sea salt. That will not compile. This does. So I have to crawl inside of the enum to get to those names. The names are now properly bound in where they belong. It turns out, according to the standard, that you can call enum class or enum struct, your choice. Doesn't make any difference. I've never seen anybody actually use it in the wild as enum struct. So I prefer enum class because that's what people will expect. If you like the behavior of old enums, you can force the names out, you know, at your choice. Here's a case where I created an enum of soul food, barbecue, and fast food. And I'm exporting soul food and barbecue because I would rather eat those. That's not what I wanted. OK. Integral conversion. Old style enums convert to int very easily. You barely have to blink at them, and they turn into integers. And they don't. You have to do a static cast in order to get them back. Scoped enums have to be cast in order to turn into an integral type. And to go in the opposite direction from integral type to enum, you have to do a cast on either kind. So just for grins, I tried doing a bunch of thrashing about with a plain old enum and an enum class. And even though it looks like I'm doing operations on these enums, I'm really not on the weak enums. I'm doing operations on integers. And when I'm comparing these types, they compare just fine. They're ordered. So less than works inside of an enum. Not equals works inside of an enum. You can do case statements. There's a new facility with C++11. You can ask for the underlying type of an enum. And you can ask for the underlying type of either kind of enum. And somebody might ask, why would you use enum class? Why would you prefer this? So my model is that you get more type safety out of it. So I like them. You cannot put member functions on enums, but you can overload with them. So here I've got a class of spices. And I've got an isHot free function that takes in spices and returns true or false based on here. So you can't do member functions, but you can still overload with them. One of the things I thought would be kind of interesting to play with, and you guys can say this is not a good idea. Oh, let's see. There's a hand in the back. Why are you not allowed to?
Member functions. It's okay to understand that they don't support member functions. Why would you consider to allow using static member functions?
Okay, so the question is, why not allow static member functions on enums?
Yeah, because lots of the time you want to convert an enum value to a string, for example, and you have to write external functions that will accept enum.
Yeah.
And enum class should be kind of perfect place for that static function placeholder.
Yeah. So. There you would have to ask a committee member why, you know, if someone even considered putting that kind of thing into an enum. The impression that I've gotten is that I have heard a comment from one committee member is that they tried to put member functions in general into enums, and that was a catastrophe. So I don't know whether they looked at statics or not. So it occurred to me that some class enums, you might like to make it easy or at least less ugly to turn them into integrals. You might make that choice. So I made a two integral method and then set up a type trait so that I could, if I associate the type trait with the enum, then two integral just happens automatically. And that doesn't take very much code. I don't know, you know, depends on whether you find that useful. I am pretty, you know, just barely over time, so I will put in an aside. One of the reasons I got interested in enums is from Sean Parent's talks last year. He brought up using macros to provide ways of incrementing and decrementing enums so that you could use enums for indexing. So I started thinking about, you know, if you're using enums for indexing, you know, maybe this would be a good case for using class or scoped enums because they don't turn into integers easily. But there would still be an instance where you wanted to take that. And now that I'm ready to do my indexing, I need the numeric value. And exactly along the line of Sean Parent's talk, what about iterators? Is there any good reason not to provide an iterator for an enum? Well, so you can't do it, take the general case, because enumerations can have gaps anywhere. So until C++ provides compile time reflection, you can't solve the general problem. But you could do opt-in for specific special enums. Like if you know that all of your enumerations are contiguous, you could create an iterator for that. So here I've got an opt-in iterator. So I'm using traits again to opt-in. And I've created a contiguous enum tag to say, yes, I know I'm creating this enum iterator. And I'm declaring to you that these are contiguous. In my particular implementation, I attached a min value and a max value to the enum. This implementation is going to reach into the enum, grab those two values out, and it now knows where it needs to iterate. Another possibility, instead of putting them into the enumeration, would be to actually tuck them inside of the traits. So that's just kind of brief thoughts on enum iterators. And we're at the end. Final questions, or is everybody too hungry? There is a question in the back.
Maybe I missed. Could you please repeat what are constraints on underlying type?
So the question is, what are the constraints on an underlying type? The answer is that it has to be an integral type, and it can be either signed or unsigned.
So it can be another type.
I don't believe you can put another enum in as an underlying type. I think it must be an integral type.
They're not integers, integral types. So,
yeah. Yeah, okay. So Rob's point is that enums are not integral types. So, yeah. Other questions? Yes?
Does enum class solve the problem, like if you have an enum of integers and you just define exactly what you want in that class, like say days of the week or whatever? Will it prevent the user from entering a value that you didn't specifically define in that enum? I mean, like the old way you can put like 3, 4, 5, and if you didn't have it, I guess it defaults to the closest value, but enum classes,
so
that
if you,
prevents that.
Yeah, so the question was, do enums prevent invalid arguments? Say, let's just say that we've got a function that accepts an enum. Yeah. And do enums prevent invalid arguments? And enum class helps with that. In C++, you can never prevent somebody from doing something bad. You know, Rob will tell you, I did bad stuff here in my slides. So enum class will help with that. So there's no reason that someone can't take an integer, cast it into your enum type, and say, oh, you know, the compiler now believes you. You've done that cast. And it's just a static cast. So it's not a big, I'm a really scary kind of a cast. It's a static cast. So now they have that type. And it may not have been in your enumeration. But it's safer than old classic enums were. Yes, question over here.
Doing that's actually undefined behavior. Having an enum take a value that's not in the set.
Not for the old ones. As long as it was within the range of the underlying type the compiler had selected based on the enumerators you provided, then it was valid. I don't know whether that's true for enum classes.
Because I know we have this in LLVM where we implemented an optimization based on this requirement, and it broke all the code.
Okay.
So it might just be enum class, but I think it's enums in general.
No, definitely. I know it's available for the old enums.
So it has to be explicit in the new one, and there's implicit in the old one.
Yeah. So the point was that one of our audience members, let's see if I can rephrase this, and you can correct me, that it's undefined behavior to put a value into an enum class that doesn't fit inside, is not one of the actual members. And Rob's not so sure whether that's true. Did I state what you?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. So I actually got that. Yes.
There's a very subtle point with enums that doesn't come up much for forward declarations. If you think about functions and variables with static duration, they have linkage that's handled by the linker exclusively. And if you forward declare an enum and the translation unit never sees the actual definition, you run the risk from a software engineering point of view of getting out of sync. This isn't true with classes because you can't do much with a class pretty much at all until you've seen its definition. So while you can forward declare it, that's fine. You will see it later. That's not true of functions. It's not true of variables with static storage duration. And apparently, it's not true of enums. So all I need to do is change from char to int.
Hold on. I'm not going to be able to repeat this.
All right, I'll try to summarize it.
Yeah, so let's get this on the record.
Until now, we've had two kinds of entities in C++ that are handled by the linker. They are they're functions, plain old functions, and variables with static storage duration. And this is now a third. And so if we're not careful, what can happen with a forward declaration is that the translation unit that sees the forward declaration never sees the definition. And therefore, if either is changed, particularly the definition, the declaration keeps on going, and it's not noticed until we get to the linker. So it's just the third of, used to be two, now here's a third one. So that could be a problem if we're not careful. It just means that people who are developing libraries need to be cognizant that they should publish the declaration of the forward declaration in some corresponding way so that people can include it in both the translation unit that provides a definition as well as whoever's using it. That was my thought.
Okay, thanks. So you guys probably all want to get some lunch. So anything else? Okay, we're done. Thank you all.